turning my fear to faith, my doubt to praise, and everything is grace. True in the pouring rain, true in the crashing wave, it's true even in my pain. My heart can say that everything is grace.
There's a father when your father walks away, a friend when no one else knows your name, a light that shines when all the world goes dark, a hand that holds you when you fall apart. His name is Healer of your deepest scars, Father of your broken heart. His name is mercy, power, freedom. Oh, his name, oh, his name, his name is Jesus. Start caving in. Tears you cry will turn to victory. The sun will rise and soon your eyes will see. His name is Healer of your deepest scars, Father. Nothing is stronger, nothing is stronger, nothing is stronger than his name. Nothing is stronger, nothing is stronger, nothing is stronger than his name. Nothing is stronger. Deepest scars, Father.
flags were waving and there you were, in the middle of a sunny day parade. The crowds were cheering, the sky was clear, not a worry in the world. Marching on, sure and steady, strong and straight. Take another step and another step and another step. Then the lightning flashed, the thunder crashed, and suddenly it began to rain and everybody ran. And the sky went black as midnight and you couldn't see. Paralyzed by what you just can't understand. And now here you are, you're afraid to move. You don't know where to go, you don't know what to do. None of us can even begin to truly understand what it really means till all the lights go out. And there we are, nothing to hold on to. But the promises God's made to me.
Welcome to Woodward Avenue Baptist Church. My name is McKenna Morrison and I'm excited you're here today. We are a church family committed to reaching people in the Shoals and beyond with the gospel of Jesus Christ and equipping them to become fully devoted disciples. If you're looking for a church home in the Shoals, I hope you will prayerfully consider Woodward Avenue Baptist Church. Let's take a look at some of our upcoming activities.
We're excited to host singer-songwriter Sandra McCracken in concert here at Woodward Avenue Baptist on March the 8th at 7 p.m. Tickets are available for $15 in advance through our church website on the events page. We hope you'll make plans to be at this concert and bring plenty of friends with you.
If you would like to financially support those who will be participating in the mission trip to Central Asia, you may do so by giving online and choosing the mission trip fund from the fund options or by designating on your offering envelope.
It's not too late to join one of our discipleship classes. We'll meet tonight at 5:30 and we hope you will join one of our great studies. There are 5 classes to choose from and you can read about them in your worship guide.
For more information about our church ministries or upcoming events, download our church app to your smartphone and tablet or visit our website at www.woodwardavenuebaptist.org. There you will find links to our various social media sites. We hope you will take the time to connect with us. If you would like a copy of today's service, you may call the church office at 256-383-4078. Thank you for worshiping with us today.
Good morning. Let's stand and sing together. There is a voice that calms the oceans and made a blind. It is a simple voice that is calling, calling out today to you. spots and made him clean. It is the same hand that awards will do. Take away the sins of you and me. But he is the God who reigns, the only one who saves. The name above all names, he is Jesus. He is the God who reigns, the only one who saves. The name above all names, he is Jesus. He is the Prince of Peace, Majesty. He is the Prince of Peace, Majesty, King of Kings. He is Jesus. He is the God who reigns, the only one who saves. The name above all names, he is Jesus. Thank you so much. You guys can be seated.
Before we pray, I want to call your attention to this little handout that you've got inside your bulletin. Today begins our week of prayer for North American missions, in particular our emphasis for the Annie Armstrong Easter offering. So I encourage you to take this and maybe put it on your refrigerator. If you've got stuff hanging on your refrigerator, put it somewhere where you will see it, and you'll notice that each day there is a place and particular missionaries to be praying for. This begins, again, our emphasis for North American missions. We partner through our cooperative program and through our North American Mission Board. We partner with churches all around the globe that are supporting missionaries in North America. And so we want to take a moment this week to be praying for them, and also to remind you that we're going to be taking up, from now until the end of April, we'll be taking up our Annie Armstrong Easter offering. Our goal for the church is to raise $5,000 to support North American missions. So be praying about that this week, and be praying about it as we continue the Easter season. Let's pray together right now. Father, thank you for the opportunity to gather together, to sing your praises, to be able to hear from your word. Lord, we come right now united together as a church family, but also uniting together as Southern Baptists across the globe to lift up our North American Mission Board and the missionaries that are appointed through them. Lord, I pray for the work that's being done, the churches that are being planted, and Lord, I pray that we would be a partner in the gospel ministry in North America as we support these missionaries through our Annie Armstrong Easter offering and through our cooperative program. Lord, thank you for the ways that we get to partner together with all of these other churches, and Lord, thank you for the work that's being done through the North American Mission Board. Lord, I pray as we continue in our time of worship and celebration, Lord, if there's someone here today that doesn't know Christ, may today be the day where they make the decision to follow Jesus, to make him the Lord of their life. Lord, I pray that as we leave this place in a little while, Lord, that we would leave taking the name of Jesus with us and going into our homes, our schools, our workplaces, wherever we find ourselves, Lord, let us tell someone the good news of Christ. It's in his mighty name that we pray. Amen. What is good to see all of you here this morning. I know that there are a lot of options, if you're a guest with us this morning, a lot of options for churches for you to attend, and we're delighted that you've chosen to worship with Woodward Avenue Baptist Church this morning. On your way in, you should have received a bulletin, and inside that bulletin, you'll notice we have a little tear-off portion. We would love to have a record of your attendance, and so if you're a first-time guest, or maybe it's been a long time, we would love for you to fill that out. Just let us know you're here, and you can get that back to us either by putting it in the offering plate as it goes by in a moment, or at the end of the service, I'll be standing in the back. You can just come and hand it to me and say, Will, I'm a guest, and I'd love to get to know who you are. And also, on the back of that, even if you're a member of the church, you can put in prayer requests. You just put in who you want us to be praying for, and every Tuesday, our staff gets together, and we lift up all of these requests so we can join you in prayer. also want you to know that you don't, let's say Tuesday comes around and you didn't put it in the offering plate. If you've got our church app, if you go to the More section of our church app, you'll find a place where you can submit prayer requests directly through our church app. We get those every week and we pray for those as well. So I want to encourage you to let the staff join with you in those prayer requests. Let's take a moment now to welcome one another. Maybe stand up, find somebody you haven't talked to yet this morning. Let them know you're glad they're here.
Worship the King, all glorious above. Oh, gratefully sing His wonderful love. Our shield and defender, the Ancient of Days, revealing in splendor and glory. Oh, with praise. Oh, tell His might, we'll sing of His grace, whose robe is the light, whose canopy is space, His chariots around the deep thunderclouds form, darkens His path on the wings of the storm. Thank you.
this earth you formed was not your home, and a love like this the world has never known. A crown of thorns to mock your name, forgiveness fell upon your face, and a love like this the world. On the altar of our praise, let there be no higher name. Jesus, Son of God, you laid down your perfect life. You are the sacrifice. Jesus, Son of God, you are Jesus, Son of God. You took our sin, you bore our shame, you rose to life, you defeated the grave. In a love like this, the world has never known. You took our sin, you bore our shame, you rose to life, you defeated the grave. In a love like this, the world has never known. Son of God, you laid down your perfect life. You are the sacrifice. Jesus, Son of God, you are Jesus, Son of God. Altar of our praise,
let there be no higher name.
Jesus, Son of God.
Jesus, Son of God. You laid down your perfect life. You are the sacrifice. Jesus, Son of God.
On the altar of our praise. You are the sacrifice, Jesus, Son of God. You are Jesus, Son of God. Be lifted higher than all you've overcome. Your name be louder than any other song. Your love, the
cross was enough. The cross was enough. Be lifted higher than all you've overcome. Your name be louder than any other song. There is no power that can come against your love. The cross was enough. The cross was enough. The cross was enough. The cross was enough.
Would you please remain standing for our offertory prayer?
Good morning. I call your attention to our missionary moment in our bulletin this morning, and we read about Jacob and Jessica Dahl, who are two of our missionaries on university campus in Washington State. They are recipients of our prayers and our money, as Brother Will has already talked about this morning. So let's pray for them and others as they minister in God's name, and let's pray for one another. Our Father, we're so thankful for the blessings you've granted us, and we've been reminded today of the great gift that you gave us in your Son. I thank you, Lord, for all of those blessings, and as each one has come today, I pray, Father, that you might meet needs in people's lives, that we might also be the instrument of meeting those needs as you see and as you guide us. Thank you, Father, and as we receive this offering now, we ask that you would bless both the gift and the giver. And I pray, Lord, again for our services today, that you'll guide Brother Will in the message that's soon to come, and that it would speak to our hearts today and challenge us. Thank you again. We ask in Jesus' name. Amen.
With our hearts restored.
you've heard us talk a lot over the last few weeks about the Sandra McCracken concert that we're having Thursday night, and we wanted you to see a little bit of what you can expect Thursday night. That was Sandra. That was a song that you all probably are familiar with called We Will Feast in the House of Zion. Sandra's going to be here Thursday night at 7 o'clock. Mackenzie Lockhart, who you also know well, she'll be opening up. But I hope you'll make plans to join us. I'll be at the Welcome Center after our service this morning selling tickets. They'll be available at the door, or they're available all week long at our website, woodwardavenuebaptist.org. But I hope you'll make plans to join us and to bring some friends with you as well.
Never.
Appreciate the choir leading us in worship. At this time, we'll dismiss our children onto Children's Church. You see Miss McKenna back there, ready to take the kids on and teach the kids. For those of you sticking around in the worship center, I want to invite you, if you have a Bible, to turn to the Gospel according to John. We'll be in the second half of the third chapter, continuing our sermon series entitled Rediscovering Jesus. While you're turning there, let me kind of give you a bit of a reminder as to what we've been talking about. We've been going through this year a sermon series going through the Gospel of John, looking at Jesus and what the Bible says Jesus is and what the Bible says Jesus demands of us. And in doing so, we've been reminded of a simple truth, and that is that John was writing his gospel for the purpose of people to believe in Jesus, and not just to believe, but by believing have life in his name. You'll remember I told you John chapter 20, verse 31 is sort of the theme verse for the gospel according to John. John says, "Now Jesus did many other signs in the presence of the disciples, which are not written in this book, but these are written so that you may believe that Jesus is the Christ, the Son of God, and that by believing you may have life in his name." What we find is John giving us the stories that he gives us for one purpose, and that is so that people will believe that Jesus is the Christ and that they will have life in the name of Jesus. And you'll also remember that as we've gone through this series, what we've done is we've noticed that the outline that John uses is to give us a picture of who Jesus is. We have a real simple outline to the book of John. First section, chapters 1 through 12, is the book of signs. And I told you, this is where we see in John chapter 1, verse 9, John writes, he says, "The light shines in the darkness, but the darkness has not overcome it." The book of signs tells us about the light shining in the darkness. And so Jesus is the light shining in the darkness. And these are the signs that we see of Jesus, the shining light in the darkness. And then there is the book of glory. The book of glory goes from chapters 13 through chapter 21. And so whereas the book of signs is the light shining in the darkness, the book of glory is the demonstration of the darkness not overcoming the light. So John says in chapter 1, verse 9, "The light shines in the darkness, and the darkness has not overcome it." The light shining, book of signs, the darkness not overcoming it, it is the book of glory. And so we are in the midst of the book of signs. And the book of signs itself can be divided into two different sections. There is what John would describe as the institutions of Judaism. This is him saying all of these institutions are, Jesus is greater than all of them. And so in those we saw the wedding, we saw the temple where he cleanses the temple. We see him dealing with a member of the Sanhedrin. Jesus is greater than all of the institutions. And then later we'll see, beginning in chapter 5 through chapter 10, we'll see Jesus is not just greater than the institutions, he is greater than even the festivals of Judaism. And so John's point is to say to us that Jesus is the greatest. He is what we need, and he is greater than all that we can think, greater than any other religious institution, greater than any other religious festival. Jesus is the greatest. And so as we've been going through our story of John, what we have found is that Jesus is greater than the institution of marriage. He's greater than the temple because he goes in and he cleanses the temple. He's greater than the Sanhedrin because last week we saw him dealing with Nicodemus and he told a member of the Sanhedrin, "You must be born from above. You must be born again." And so we saw that conversation. Now, in this same chapter, John chapter 3, the conversation transitions. Jesus is not having conversation with Nicodemus. Rather, now we see John the Baptist having conversation with his own disciples. So we pick up the story in John chapter 3, beginning in verse 22. It says, "After this, Jesus and his disciples went into the Judean countryside, and he remained there with them and was baptizing. John was baptizing at Aenon near Salem, because water was plentiful there, and people were coming and being baptized. For John had not yet been put in prison. Now a discussion arose between some of John's disciples and a Jew over purification. And they came to John and said to him, 'Rabbi, he who was with you across the Jordan, to whom you bore witness, look, he is baptizing, and all are going to him.' John answered, 'A person cannot receive even one thing unless it is given him from heaven. You yourselves bear witness, or you yourselves bear me witness that I said, I am not the Christ, but I have been sent before him. The one who has the bride is the bridegroom. The friend of the bridegroom who stands and hears him rejoices greatly at the bridegroom's voice. Therefore, this joy of mine is now complete. He must increase, but I must decrease. He who comes from above is above all. And he who is of the earth belongs to the earth and speaks in an earthly way. He who comes from heaven is above all. He bears witness to what he has seen and heard, yet no one receives his testimony. Whoever receives his testimony sets his seal to this, that God is true. For he whom God has sent utters the words of God, for he gives the Spirit without measure. The Father loves the Son and has given all things into his hand. Whoever believes in the Son has eternal life. Whoever does not obey the Son shall not see life, but the wrath of God remains on him. Here we find the second segment of John chapter 3, whereas chapter 1 is dealing with Jesus and his conversation with Nicodemus. Again, we have dialogue teaching us great things about Jesus, but Jesus is not in this dialogue. This dialogue is between John and his disciples. And we ask ourselves, why does John the Apostle, the writer of the Gospel, give us this story about John the Baptist? Why is he telling us this story? We've already been reminded that everything John writes is for a purpose. Everything that John writes is so that we may believe that Jesus is the Christ, the Son of God, and that by believing we may have life. So what is it about this story that John the Apostle is trying to portray to us about John the Baptist, and in particular, not just about John the Baptist, what is he trying to portray to us about Jesus? I think there's a lot of reasons why John might have included this text in his gospel. One reason that scholars think that John included this is that in the early days of the church, there was a lot of discussion about the role of John the Baptist in early Christianity. There was a lot of people in the early church that still looked at John the Baptist not just as someone who would be the forerunner to Christ. There are many who looked at John the Baptist as being the Christ himself. And so some scholars have speculated that here John the Apostle is writing about John the Baptist in order to explain that John the Baptist is not the Christ, in order to explicitly declare that John the Baptist is not the Christ. We see hints of John the Baptist following in the book of Acts. If you're familiar with the book of Acts, you'll be familiar with Acts chapter 19, where Paul is in Ephesus, and in coming to Ephesus, he runs into two followers of John the Baptist, and he begins a conversation with these followers, and he asks them, he says, have you received the Holy Spirit? And they said, no, we've just had John's baptism. And Paul says, well, John's baptism is great. It's a baptism of repentance. But what you need is a Christian baptism. You need a baptism that is symbolic of the death of Christ, the resurrection of Christ. You need the baptism of Christ. And so they're baptized in the name of Christ. They receive the Holy Spirit. And so we see early on in Acts chapter 19 that there were a lot of people who were followers of John the Baptist, and they had trouble coming into the church. They didn't look at Jesus the same way as even John the Baptist did. And so there's a lot of scholars that think, well, John is putting this here in order for the early church to understand that John the Baptist is not greater than Jesus, that John the Baptist is simply a forerunner to the Christ. And I think there's a lot of truth to that. I think the scholars have something there, that John is trying to explain to the early church that John the Baptist had a particular role, but that role was not to be the Savior of the world. I think that's a likely reason that John the Apostle wrote this. But I think another reason is that John the Apostle is trying to help us to understand what it looks like to truly follow Jesus and what is expected, what is the expected behavior of a follower of Jesus. Think about the contrast for a moment. You have Nicodemus. In the early part of chapter 3, Nicodemus is a religious scholar. He resides in Jerusalem. He's a member of the Sanhedrin. And he is told, you must be born from above, or you must be born again. Now, in the second half, we have John the Baptist, who is not a religious scholar. John the Baptist, who doesn't reside in Jerusalem. Rather, John the Baptist is some crazy guy out in the wilderness baptizing people. And yet John the Baptist gives us the picture or the model of what it looks like to follow Jesus more than Nicodemus does. I think John is giving us a contrast here. He is saying you can be like Nicodemus and have all of the right answers and be known as a scholar, or you can be like John the Baptist and be some crazy guy in the woods, but know how to treat Jesus and know how to respond to Christ. What we're seeing in John's gospel is a picture of what it means to follow Jesus. And I believe that this picture, this story that he gives us some truths that we need to understand even within the church today. Let's look at the scenario that's unfolding. Jesus has moved his ministry now to Judea. Now, John is the only one of all the Gospels. You remember that the first three Gospels, Matthew, Mark, and Luke, we call them the Synoptic Gospels because they kind of follow the same time frame. But John is the only Gospel that tells us that Jesus had an early Judean ministry. The other Gospels have Jesus in Galilee early, and then he comes, eventually makes his way to Judea. Here we see Jesus in Judea at the same time that John the Baptist is in Judea. And it tells us that Jesus is baptizing, although in chapter 4, verse 2, we'll get a clarification that it's not actually Jesus, but his disciples. John is the only one that tells us that Jesus had a baptizing ministry, or that his disciples were involved in a baptizing ministry. And so Jesus is out there baptizing in the Judean wilderness. John is out there baptizing in the Judean wilderness. And the followers of John get into a discussion with a certain Jew. The Bible just says a Jew comes. It says in verse 25, now a discussion arose between some of John's disciples and a Jew, and the discussion is over purification. Now, John has already demonstrated to us, John the Apostle has already demonstrated to us that Jesus is greater than any Jewish purification that exists. You'll remember at the wedding of Cana, what happened at Cana? Jesus took those purification jugs, he filled them to the brim with wine, basically saying, hey, I'm greater than anything these jugs could ever hold. I'm greater than anything that Jewish purification can provide. But now there's a debate between John's disciples, that is John the Baptist's disciples, and a Jew. And we don't know what that debate is about. We don't get any lengthy discussion. Perhaps the Jew was wondering, why are Jews being baptized? Why are people coming out to the wilderness to be baptized? In this day and time, baptism was not a normal thing. Jews did not get baptized. They were involved in the purification ceremonies of the washing of their hands and the washing of other things. Gentiles were really the only ones that would ever get baptized. In other words, be fully immersed underwater. So maybe the discussion was, why are Jews getting baptized? Why are you baptizing Jews and not Gentiles? I mean, maybe that was discussion. But nevertheless, that discussion led to a broader discussion. And that is, the disciples of John the Baptist go to John the Baptist and they say, hey, John, we've been talking about baptism a lot. We got into this discussion with a guy the other day, and we realized something. That guy that you baptized, remember back beyond the Jordan? That guy you baptized? Well, it turns out he's now baptizing people. And as a matter of fact, he's not just baptizing people. More people are going to him than are coming to us. And so they get this competitive spirit. They say, John, how can that be? If you baptize him, doesn't that mean you're greater than he is? Shouldn't people be coming to you because you baptized first? They want to know why John is allowing people to go to Jesus' disciples to be baptized instead of telling all the people that they need to come to him. And that brings us to what I believe is the first truth that we need to learn from this text that is applicable today. And that is that a competitive spirit is contrary to the gospel. A competitive spirit is contrary to the gospel. Here we find these disciples of John the Baptist saying to John, hey, John, why is everybody going there and not here? Why are people not coming to us? It's this idea that we ought to be bringing in more people. We ought to be doing more. We want the attention more than anybody else. We ought to be getting all of the focus. And notice John the Baptist's reply. I mean, you'll see there, let's just pick up in verse 25, a discussion between John the Baptist and a Jew over purification. Then in 26, they came to John and said to him, Rabbi, he who is with you across the Jordan, of whom you bore witness, look, he is baptizing, And all are going to him. They don't even mention Jesus by name. They say, hey, you know that guy? You know, yeah, the guy who had the dove come and descend, you know, that whole experience. Well, that guy's now baptizing, and more are going to him. And verse 27, John says, a person cannot receive even one thing unless it is given to him from heaven. You yourself bear witness that I said, I am not the Christ, but I have been sent before him. The one who has the bride is the bridegroom, and the friend of the bridegroom who stands and hears him rejoices greatly at the bridegroom's voice. They say, John, you're the Baptist. People should be coming to you to be baptized, not to Jesus and his disciples. And John says, hey guys, you know what? That's the bridegroom over there, and I'm just the friend. Have you ever been to a wedding? I mean, you've all been to a wedding, right? You go to a wedding, you've got the bride and the bridegroom, and man, it is their day, isn't it? Really, it's the bride's day. Everybody wants to see the bride, or everybody wants to take pictures with the bride. Everybody's there to witness the bride. What would happen if in the middle of the wedding photography session that takes place usually at the end of the wedding ceremony, while you're all waiting at the rehearsal, or at the, not the rehearsal, but the dinner, you're waiting to eat all the food, waiting for the bride and the groom to come, what would happen if one of the friends stood up and said, hey, look, you see all these pictures that are being made? I need to be in some of these pictures. I mean, what would happen if you just showed up and said, I know the bride looks great in her wedding dress, and I know the bridegroom looks great in his tux, but you know what? There are no pictures of me at this wedding. I'll be honest with you. There's been times as the preacher, can I let you in on a secret? Preachers, at the wedding, we have a real important role, but nobody notices us. Like, nobody cares about the preacher. I go to weddings, and I've written out wedding ceremonies, and I'll give the wedding ceremony, and the bride says I do, the groom says I do, and usually I get like one picture, and then I get to take off my robe or my coat, whatever, and nobody else wants pictures with the preacher. What if I just stood up and said, hey guys, this would not be happening without me. I need to be in all of the pictures. John the Baptist is saying, that's foolish. Why do the friends show up to a wedding? Because they're celebrating the bride and the bridegroom. They're celebrating what's taking place, and they're rejoicing. John is saying, look, it's not about me. It's not about me coming in and saying, I need all the attention, or I need to be doing all the baptisms. I'm just the friend who has shown up at the wedding, and I'm just grateful that I get to be a part of witnessing the wedding. I'm just grateful that I get to see the bridegroom in action, that I get to see all that's going on. What if the friend said, hey, I should be a part of the honeymoon? It's not fair y'all get to go on all this stuff. It should be about me. I'm going to go and join you on your trip to Hawaii or on your cruise. John the Baptist says, no, that's not why I'm here. All I am is the friend. I'm the friend that gets to witness all that's going on. You see, what John is teaching us here is he's teaching us that a competitive spirit is contrary to the gospel. And the reason we need to know this even today is because, I mean, this mentality is not gone. It's not like it existed at that time and then it's disappeared. It exists today in the church, and it exists in all areas of the church. We get that competitive spirit where we say, well, you know, why do they get to be the Sunday school teacher and I don't? Or why do they get the solo and I don't? Why do they get to get elected deacon and I didn't? Or why do they get to be a part of the committee or the chairman of that committee and I don't? That should be me. We get this competitive spirit and we think, hey, it ought to be about me. John is teaching us that competitive spirit is contrary to the gospel. That competitive spirit may be the spirit of Nicodemus in early chapter 3, but it's not the spirit of John the Baptist in the end of chapter 3. We do it not just in our own church. What do we say? Why is everybody going to that church down the street instead of our church? Why are they going there? They should be coming here. We get that competitive spirit. And we think, man, if we just did this, maybe we could pull people from that church. Or if we just did that, maybe people would come here. We get this competitive spirit, and we somehow make it about us. And it is not about us. John is telling us that a competitive spirit is contrary to the gospel. Another truth that we see in John's teaching here, John the author's teaching here about John the Baptist, is that John the Baptist not only teaches us that a competitive spirit is contrary to the gospel, but John the Baptist also teaches us that anything above Jesus is idolatry. Anything above Jesus is idolatry. Look at what John says. John's disciples are coming to him. We should be doing all the baptizing. We should have the market cornered on baptism in Judea. That should be us. And John says, you know what? I'm just the friend attending the wedding, celebrating the bride and the bridegroom. Then he gives us this remarkable statement. If you're the kind of person that underlines things in your Bible, I would underline this text. Verse 30, John says, he must increase, but I must decrease. If you're looking for another memory verse, this would be another good one. He must increase, and I must decrease. What John the Baptist is saying is that anything that rises above Jesus Christ is idolatry. John the Baptist is telling us that we must make Jesus primary in all that we do. Jesus supersedes everything. The proper response to Christ is to say, Jesus, you get all the attention. I don't need any of it. You get all the glory. I don't need any of it. You just keep increasing. I'm just going to keep decreasing. That is what John the Baptist is saying. John the Baptist is showing us that if we put anything above idolatry, anything, or if we put anything above Jesus, it is idolatry. And then look what John is talking about. So here is the immediate context of this story. It's really a competition between preachers, isn't it? Oh, I like this preacher, and you like this preacher. The people are going to Jesus and not John the Baptist. It's a competition between religious leaders. And John refuses to play the game. John says, it's not about me. I'm going to decrease so that he can increase. We get involved in this religious game, and I mean, it happened in the early church. Look at the book of Corinth, or the book of Corinthians. In Corinth, that chapter 1, I follow Paul. No, I follow Apollos. I follow Cephas or Peter. All of them saying, well, I've got the better religious teacher. Be like going to school. When you were a kid, did you ever play the game where my dad could beat up your dad? Anybody ever? I mean, when we were in grade school, it was like, my dad is tougher, he's stronger. Have you ever like the grown-up version for church, maybe like my preacher's better than your preacher? You ever played that game? I hope not. I mean, but that's essentially what they're saying here. Hey, my preacher is better than your preacher. He tells the funnier story. He is better. He does this or that. And John the Baptist is saying, look, I'm not going to get involved in that because anything above Jesus is idolatry. But not just religious teachers. We're talking about good activities. We're talking about baptism here. These guys are excited about people getting baptized. That's a good thing. That's a very good thing. And yet even good things can rise above Jesus in our life. Even those things that are important and great, good family activities can rise above Jesus and they become idolatry. Or even things that are great, our patriotism, our love for America can rise above Jesus and become idolatry. Patriotism is a good thing, but when it rises above Jesus, it becomes idolatry. And what John is saying is, here's a rule that I want to have in life. I decrease and he increases. That's my rule. Anything that begins to increase becomes idolatry if it's not Jesus. John teaches us truth number one, a competitive spirit is contrary to the gospel. Truth number two, anything above Jesus is idolatry. And then truth number three that I believe John is teaching us. So here is a question that we have to deal with. In verse 30, he says, he must increase, I must decrease. The question is are the words verses 31 through 36 Baptist? The word the words of Jesus, even though our red letter Bibles may say it is, I believe that that's John's commentary on Jesus' conversation with Nicodemus. And I think John does the same thing here at the end of chapter 3. So we have John the Baptist conversation with his disciples, and then we begin in verse 31, which is John the Apostle's commentary on the conversation. So we saw that in verses 16 through 21 is John's commentary on Jesus' conversation with Nicodemus. And verses 31 through 36 are John's commentary on John the Baptist's conversation with his disciples. And here's what John has to say. John says, "He who comes from above is above all. He who is of the earth belongs to the earth and speaks in earthly way. He who comes from heaven is above all. He bears witness to what he has seen and heard, yet no one receives his testimony. Whoever receives his testimony sets his seal to this, that God is true. For he whom God has sent utters the words of God, for he gives the Spirit without measure. The Father loves the Son and has given all things into his hand. Whoever believes in the Son has eternal life. Whoever does not obey the Son shall not see life, but the wrath of God remains on him." This is John's commentary, John the author, John the apostle, his commentary on the conversation with John the Baptist. What is he saying? John is saying, here's what we need to learn about Jesus. Here's what John the Baptist has taught us about Jesus. We've already seen through the conversation, John the Baptist has taught us about being competitive is contrary to the gospel. Having that competitive spirit when the church is concerned is contrary. He's already told us that anything above Jesus is idolatry. But I believe right here, John's commentary is to say this, that when we follow Jesus, Jesus gets all of us. Jesus demands total commitment from us. Jesus demands our total commitment. Here's where I see that. Look at verse 33. Whoever receives his testimony, that is the testimony of Jesus Christ, whoever receives his testimony sets his seal to this. So here's what John is saying. Whoever receives the testimony of Christ is putting their own seal on the words of Jesus Christ. John is telling us, John the Apostle is telling us that what we've learned about Jesus is that Jesus is different than anything else that Judaism has to offer. Jesus is greater than the wedding. Jesus is greater than the purification. Jesus is greater than the temple. Jesus is greater than the Sanhedrin. And even the one who is the closest to godliness in all the New Testament, John the Baptist, Jesus is even greater than John the Baptist. And what John is telling us, John's commentary is telling us, is that since Jesus is greater even than John the Baptist, we must understand that Jesus comes from somewhere else. Verse 31, he who comes from above is above all. Remember what Jesus told Nicodemus? You must be born from where? From above. How do you get born from above? Well, John the Apostle is saying Jesus is the one who comes from above. John is saying to us that when we receive Jesus, he gets all of us. Why does he get all of us? Because he is the one who is from above. He is the one who receives all the glory in our life. He's the one who gets all of our attention. He's the one who is from above. And when we receive him, what do? We give our seal of approval. You may know this, but back in this day and time, when a king wanted to seal some kind of declaration or make some kind of proclamation, the king would write a letter, or his scribe would write a letter. The king would take his seal, they would put wax on the paper, and then the king would put his seal saying, "I approve of all that is in this letter." Kind of like if you watch politics today and you get this senator that's running for something, "I approve this message." You know, you get that approval. I mean, that's essentially what the king's seal was saying. Everything that's in this declaration comes from me. I am making this declaration. This is the language that's being used in verse 33 when he says, whoever receives the testimony of Jesus puts his or her seal saying, "I agree with everything." And so what John is telling us is to follow Jesus means we approve of his message. It means we approve of all that he has to offer, and it means we are yielding our life over to him. Why would we do that? Why would we yield our life over to him? Why would we give our seal of approval on Jesus? John tells us we do it because, verse 34, for he whom God has sent utters the words of God. So we give our seal of approval because Jesus utters the words of God. Not only does he utter the words of God, he also gives the Spirit without measure. The Father loves the Son and has given all things into his hand. Whoever believes in the Son has eternal life. Whoever does not obey the Son shall not see life, but the wrath of God remains on him. What is John telling us? John is saying, by giving our seal of approval, we are approving to the words of God. We are approving to the Spirit being poured out without measure. We are giving our approval to eternal life. We are saying, Jesus, you get all of me because I want all of you. You get all of me because you're the only one worthy of all of me. You get all of me because anything less is idolatry. That's what John is saying. So John is taking this story of John the Baptist and his disciples, and he's telling us today, he's saying, that competitive spirit is contrary to the gospel. It's not about them or me. It's about Jesus. And that anything that rises above Christ in our life is idolatry. And that we give our seal of approval to Jesus Christ. He gets all of us. We can't partially prove it. We can't say, I approve some of the words that Jesus has to say. I approve some of what he has to say, some of what he's doing. No, we either give him all or nothing. And that's what Jesus demands from us. So this morning, as we contemplate the words that John gives us this morning, my question to you is, have you placed your seal of approval on Jesus Christ? Have you said, I approve of his words, I approve of his life, I approve of his message, and I want the eternal life that comes from being a part of his family? By placing my seal on Christ, I'm placing my seal on my eternity, saying, I belong to Jesus, and he has saved me from my sin, and I have an eternity to spend with him. Failure to give Jesus everything puts us in that category in verse 36 that says, whoever does not obey the Son shall not see life, but the wrath of God remains on him. This morning, have you placed your seal of approval on Jesus Christ? Can you say with John the Baptist, he must increase and I must decrease? If not, what's keeping you from doing that? What's keeping you from saying, Jesus, you get all of me? What's keeping you from saying, Jesus, I must decrease, you must increase? What's stopping you? Let me encourage you, whatever's holding you back, today's the day to give it up. Today's the day to say, you know what, Jesus, you get even this. You get these things that I've put above you. I'm repenting of my sin of idolatry, and I'm giving you my life. This morning, would you do that? Would you say, Jesus, you get all of me? Let's pray together. Holy God, thank you for your word this morning. Thank you for the challenge that comes from reading your word. And Lord, today we say collectively as a church, we want all of you. And so you get all of us. Lord, we collectively say as Woodward Avenue Baptist Church this morning, we don't care about that competitive nature, about what's going on at the church down the street or across town or in another state. What we care about is making you increase and us decreasing. Lord, today we say as individuals, we must decrease and you must increase in our life. And Lord, I pray that you would get rid of anything that is holding us back from giving you 100%, from putting our seal of approval on your life, on your testimony, on your words. Lord, may today be the day, if there's someone that doesn't know Christ as Savior, may today be the day they say, Jesus, you get all of me. Lord, what if there's someone here that's been holding back from following you in believer's baptism, today is this day to say, Lord, I need you. And I give all of you to me. I give all of myself to you. I'm ready to follow you in believer's baptism. Lord, I pray in these next few moments as you speak to us and as you challenge us, would you convict us? Call us to repentance. May we repent of the idolatry that we place in our life. The idolatry that puts other things above you. And Lord, in these next few moments, we say, you get all of us. We pray this in the powerful name of Jesus Christ. Amen. As we come to this time of commitment, I'll be standing down front. If you've never trusted Jesus Christ as Savior, I'd love to talk to you about what it means to know Christ, Or maybe you've never followed him in believer's baptism. Just come and say, Will, I need to be baptized. I need to give Jesus all of me. However the Lord is speaking to you this morning, I pray that you would respond in obedience for your good and for God's glory as we stand and sing together.
On the altar of our praise, let there be no higher name. Jesus, Son of God, you laid down your perfect life. You are the sacrifice. Jesus, Son of God.
Sing that.
On the altar of our praise, let there be no higher name. Jesus, Son of God, you laid down your perfect life. You are the sacrifice. Jesus, Son of God, you are Jesus, Son of God. Be lifted higher than all you've overcome. Your name be louder than any other song. There is no power that can come against your love. The cross was enough. The cross was enough. Be lifted higher than all you've overcome. Your name be louder than any other song. There is no power that can come against your love. The cross was enough. 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 The cross was enough.
Sing on the altar of our praise.
On the altar of our praise, let there be no higher name. Jesus, Son of God, you laid down your perfect life. You are the sacrifice. Jesus, Son of God, you are Jesus, Son of God.
Well, I do hope you've been blessed as we've worshiped and fellowshiped together this morning. I want to mention a couple of announcements real quick. As I've already mentioned, don't forget to grab that pamphlet out of your bulletin and remember our week of prayer for Annie Armstrong Easter offering, and particularly our week of prayer for North American missions. I also want to mention that immediately following this service, every one of you are invited to our spaghetti lunch fundraiser for our students. Even if you didn't sign up, we've made extra, so there's plenty for you. Let me encourage you to go by the activities building. We will have to-go plates, so maybe you say, I can't go sit and eat, but you just want to go grab a plate. You're welcome to do that. Just swing by. There's no set cost. Whatever you want to give for the students is fine. They just want to be able to serve you and say thank you for supporting them as they prepare to do their mission trip in June. Also want to mention, as Timmy's already done so, with our Sandra McCracken concert, that's coming up this Thursday. So if you don't have your tickets, a great way to get them, right at the end of this service, Timmy or somebody will be back there to get you tickets at the Welcome Center counter, so I encourage you to do that. Want to remind our personnel team that we're going to meet at 4:30 in my office, 4:30 for our personnel committee. Encourage all of you to be there. And then last but not least, I want to remind you tonight, beginning at 5:30, we continue our discipleship classes. If you haven't been attending, it's not too late to start. You'll see a list of those classes on the bottom section of your worship guide. So I encourage you to find a class. Join us at 5:30 for wonderful discipleship classes. Timmy, will you close us in our benediction?
Let's end by singing the chorus together, Name Above All Names.
He is the God who reigns, the only one who saves,
the name above all names. He is Jesus. He is the God who reigns, the only one who saves. The name above all names. He is Jesus.
Thank you so much. You're dismissed.
About our church ministries or upcoming events, download our church app to your smartphone and tablet, or visit our website at www.woodwardavenuebaptist.org. There you will find links to our various social media sites. We hope you will take the time to connect with us. If you would like a copy of today's service, you can call our church office at 256-383-4078. Thanks for worshiping with us today.